It's showtime.
People should not be afraid of their governments. Governments should be afraid of their people.
You know, the right to bear arms is because that's the last form of defense against tyranny.
Washington is fundamentally corrupt. There are more words in the IRS code than there are in the Bible.
Made in America, heard around the world. You're listening to Blunt Force Truth. I'm your host, Mark Young, with my trusted engineer, Matt Umbarger. Matt is standing by. Matt, as we said last week, there's very little news going on.
It's just been a quiet couple of weeks, Mark.
Yeah, there's just not a lot to cover. Much happening. I was actually talking to somebody this morning and literally said, you cannot go more than 2 hours without watching the news because some major event will happen if you miss like 2 hours.
Yeah, no kidding.
Of what is going on. As we all know now, Biden has decided that retreat is the better part of valor. At this moment, the question I have is, if you're too demented to run for president, are you not too demented to be the president? And my second question is, Kamala Harris has known this for 4 years and been hiding it from the public. I mean, as much as recently as a couple days ago, she was saying how Joe is as sharp as a tack. And now all of a sudden, he's out.
And like an Olympic gymnast, he's so, you know, fit. You keep hearing about how fit.
Right. Whatever. Yeah, he was pole vaulting. He was doing all kinds of stuff. And then here's the thing that I really want people to think about. Biden leaving makes no change in what's happening in the Democratic Party. The platform is still the platform. It is still going to be foreign wars, invasion at the southern border, high inflation, higher taxes, and Green New Deals. So nothing is going to change. And I want people to think about this, and that is the Democratic Party. Anyone who's a regular listener to this show, Matt, as you know, we've been talking about Joe's dementia for 4 years. Mm-hmm. This isn't new. And I've covered his mental decline for years.
Even earlier than that. I mean, back in 16, maybe.
Yeah. So the reality is they have known about Joe's mental decline as long as I have, and they're with him. Why is it now that all the Democrats came out and said Biden has to step aside? It is not because they're concerned about the country. It is they're concerned about retaining power.
Yep. They're not even concerned about him. It's not patriotism or care for Biden. It's as soon as their seats, you know, once the House and the Senate was looking like, this is when they started to come out. And they're being lauded as whistleblowers. And it's not. They're just con artists, cover-up artists.
Because they understand that many people are straight ticket voters. And they're going to lose the Senate and they're going to lose more seats in the House with Biden at the top.
Yep.
So I want people to understand this. The Democrats came out against him out of self-preservation, not out of their concern for America.
Yep.
Now, here's the flip side of that, too, is what kind of loyalty do these people have? I mean, my God, they literally just threw the man on a trash heap after that bad performance at the debate. I mean, my God, where's your loyalty to the guy if that's what you're really about?
I think this did some damage to their credibility big time because you keep hearing one thing, and we talked about it last show or the show before, you know, after the NATO summit where he was like, and was doing his whispers and stuff like that. And it's exactly what happened. Exactly what we said happened was going to happen.
Yeah, the whispering thing was just kind of creepy. But back to what I'm saying is, this is no surprise to anyone, including them. The Democrats will have you believe that this just happened to Biden. Mm-hmm. He was sharp as a tack. He was in charge. He was pole vaulting. He was, you know, he was joining Mensa. He was doing all of this stuff. And boom, like that, he lost all of his ability. Let's keep in mind, this is a guy who on his best days, in his most, you know, youthful moment, had maybe an average IQ. No one has ever accused Joe Biden of being a genius. This is a guy who has a 50-year history of being a pathological liar. Now you layer on dementia or possibly Parkinson's. He does have a Parkinson's walk.
A shuffle.
You layer that on top of an average IQ and a pathological lying behavior, and you get Joe Biden. This is not news to them. They just literally are disloyal people who will throw anybody on a trash heap that might cost them a vote. It is simply as that.
And they were fine with all of this for all these years of, you know, him being in the office until it became so egregious they couldn't hide it anymore. It wasn't a mistake. It wasn't, oops, a whistleblower. It was that he can't talk on live TV.
Let's bring our guest in today and we'll add him to this conversation. Our guest today is Robert Gouveia. Now, he's a criminal defense attorney. We are not going to hold that against him. And I believe he's kind of like a recovering criminal defense attorney. But Robert hosts a show called Watching the Watchers Live. And this is a daily live stream. And it is dedicated to defending the American people from the corrupt federal government. And when I hear that, Robert, what comes to mind for me is the famous line of, people should not fear the government should fear the people.
And it's a great line. Yeah,
and we actually have a Blunt Force Truth t-shirt. And our t-shirt says, I love my country, but I fear my government. We should never live in fear of our government, should we?
Never. And for some reason, it's gotten very topsy-turvy over this last generation. And I think we're seeing the consequences of it, where the government can basically do whatever they want. And it seems like a large portion of the people who used to stand up and fight back against that have keeled over. And I think we saw a lot of that with the COVID transition. And we're seeing a lot of that in our political life now. Like you were explaining earlier at the opening here, there's an identity situation that has developed in our country where people just want to be on the right team. And so whether Joe Biden is competent or not, they'll be on that team and they'll use the power of that team to go after their political opponents. And for some reason, it seems like that one party has forgotten about civil liberties and about that proper balance of, you know, the government is supposed to serve the people. It's not supposed to be the other way around.
Robert, have you noticed that the same people who were trying to drive Biden out of town on a rail are now on social media calling him a great American, the most consequential president in modern history? I mean, 24 hours ago, they were literally trying to boot the guy out of the White House.
It was vicious. We saw it from every angle. We saw people who have been loyal to Joe for the last 40 years, essentially, people like Nancy Pelosi and others. And even Obama, right, who brought this guy in, made him the vice president after a whole series of failed attempts to get into the White House. Obama elevates this guy. And then all of a sudden, they turn and abandon him. It was one of the most disloyal, really disgusting things that we've ever seen. But it was like, like Brutus and Caesar. I mean, they just stabbed this guy in the back after years of propping him up. And as you mentioned, I think it's all about power. They really have no shame in their game. They are now talking about him like a hero, like a...
No, we have always said that Obama selected Biden as vice president to prove he didn't need one.
That's an interesting take. And that is basically what we got. We had a puppet placeholder Joe as a vice president, and they just elevated him into the presidency.
So now Biden has not come out and backed Harris yet.
He did. So in his official statement,
Biden did. I mean, Obama hasn't. Sorry, I was thinking the real president. Obama,
that's right,
has not come out and endorsed her.
That's right. Yeah, Obama has not yet. And people are wondering what that might mean. And I think that there's always been a little bit of a rift between the Obamas and the Bidens. And it's pure speculation. I mean, I've seen some talk about this, obviously, in the news and in some of the political gossip books and all the things that come off in the aftermath of a campaign. But Joe Biden, from my take on it, I think he wanted to be the president in 2016. He wanted to run as the heir apparent to Obama. Mm-hmm. He got thrown into the garbage back then by Barack Obama in favor of Hillary, and Hillary lost to Trump. So if you're in Biden's situation, if you're in his chair, why would he leave? Because he's already beaten Trump, theoretically, according to them, even though we know what happened in that election. But the point is, he was the next guy. Obama threw him away. And now Obama's throwing him away again. And it's not just Obama. It's Pelosi and it's all the rest of them who, like you said, up until 3 weeks ago, were on Team Joe.
Adam Schiff, Hakeem Jeffries. I mean, they've all bailed on this guy. Now, up until a couple hours before he announced, Biden was determined he wasn't leaving. What do you think threw the switch on this guy?
So it must have been an increasing pressure campaign. And I can see how it could start slow. You can start with the death by a thousand cuts. It's just one after another. One Democratic politico every single day jumps in. Okay, Joe shouldn't run. Joe shouldn't run. Joe shouldn't run. Then the money comes off. They start, the donors start threatening stuff.
The money dried up hard, yeah.
Very quickly. Then we saw Clooney come down. Hollywood, he starts to lose Hollywood. Then I think he's starting to see some polls and things like that. But I remember reading a headline or at least some clip from Pelosi saying that she was going to try it the easy way first and then the hard way second. And I'm wondering if there was a lot of threatening going on, honestly. I mean, the Biden family has been around and been in a lot of criminality or at least facing criminal exposure for a very long time. And we've covered a lot of Hunter Biden's problems. Mm-hmm. His entire laptop, I think, is just a treasure trove of criminality. So if there are other entities of the federal government that maybe Pelosi has some sway in, right? I don't know if she's talking to people at the DOJ, people at the FBI, but if they start to hint to Joe, hey, we're going to look into some of those tax filings from your brother and some of those AmeriCorps transactions with that hospital that failed in Delaware. You know, we start looking into some of these things or these other classified documents or whatever else they have over Joe. And I'm sure they have a lot. My thought is they start to bring that out. What other leverage do they have to really force him to take the exit?
I wonder if they didn't say, well, you know, we almost got Trump last week, you know?
Right. 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 And the timing on that's also very interesting, right? Well, I mean, you know, God forbid if that had not been the miracle that it was and Trump had not turned his head that way, right? If Trump is not in the equation anymore, maybe Joe Biden doesn't leave. Maybe that whole dynamic shifts.
I got to tell you, I'm going to jump over to that for a minute, if you don't mind. Right now, we know that Cheadle is being barbecued at the Congress. And the Democrats that are interviewing her, all they want to do today is talk about AR-15s.
Right.
Not about the failure of the Secret Service. We now know that the Secret Service, most of the people that were there were not even Secret Service agents. That there were assets that was moved over to protect Jill Biden, that they knew the shooter an hour before was on the property and identified as a threat, where Trump never even should have been allowed to be on the stage. And we now know that Trump's team has been asking for support for months and being denied every request that they've asked for, along with Robert Kennedy, who was denied protection. And after all, you know, who would shoot at a Kennedy?
Right.
So, I mean, he's got no risk.
Right.
But Biden denied him treatment. I think Trump actually finally embarrassed Biden into giving Bobby Kennedy security, because Trump kept posting that he deserves to have security.
Right.
I don't want to get into conspiracy theories. And by the way, I've run out of conspiracy theories because all the ones I had came true. But I don't think there was some kind of mass cover up to help this kid shoot him. I do think there was a deliberate lack of good security around Trump on the part of the Secret Service. And I'm not blaming the agents around him. But to add to that, I'm not discounting the agent's willingness to take a bullet for him. But you can't put a DEI 5'3" agent trying to block a 6'3" guy's body.
Right.
How does that work?
This whole thing is a big bundled, jumbled mess. And I think it is going to take some parsing through it to tease out what happened and how it all happened. But something we've been exploring is the framework, the mindset of the Secret Service. And in the law, what we often do is ask what somebody's mental state was, right? What were they thinking? Mm-hmm. And were they intending to commit a crime? Did they have a guilty mind? Or in the law, we call it mens rea. So there's different indicia, there's different culpable mental states that a person can have, right? Somebody, I mean, you see this all the time in murder cases where somebody can be charged with intentionally murdering somebody, right? I wake up, I have a volitional mindset, I'm going to go do this. Then you have
like first degree murder and a second degree murder or a manslaughter kind of thing.
Yeah, different mental states. So then one might be a heat of passion, right? So you didn't have the actual intention to go do the thing, but something got out of control and then something happened. And so when we talk about the Secret Service, we were going through and parsing through the different possibilities. On one hand, you could say on one end of the spectrum, this is just a pure accident, right? Nobody screwed anything up. Mm-hmm. This was just a sophisticated shooter who got on the roof and outsmarted everybody with drones and all the stuff. Obviously, I think that is also ridiculous. There was clearly negligence. The question is it criminal culpability and criminal negligence, or was it intentional negligence or they wanted this to happen? So then on the other end of that spectrum, you could say, as you articulated, that there could be a theory that the Secret Service wanted it to happen, right? They were organizing it, directing this guy, go get on the roof, and he's going to be here at this time. And I think
this kid was not Jason Bourne.
Right. Right. And so that's probably also maybe not in evidence, right? The Secret Service director is not going to be sending this kid a text message to go shoot Trump. But the truth is probably somewhere in the middle there. And when we look at all of the incompetence, right? Incompetence after incompetence after incompetence, you start adding all of those up, it suddenly doesn't look like incompetence anymore. And the government has this neat little trick that they always do where they just blame everything on this magical incompetence fairy. And suddenly nobody is liable. There's nobody responsible for criminal negligence, for actually enabling an environment to be had where Trump could be shot in the head, shot in the face, right in the ear. So,
well, let me give you an example. They found cocaine in the White House some time back. 5 days after they found the cocaine, Secret Service came out and said, all right, we've ended our investigation. We're never going to know who owns it. If you can smuggle in a bag of cocaine into the most secure building on the planet, how could you not also be able to smuggle in a bag of anthrax?
Right.
So how do you end? And because that's what's going to happen with this investigation. The investigators are going to investigate themselves. It's going to get no play, and it's going to be, well, there were mistakes made, but we've made things to improve it. We've changed it.
Right.
That's going to be the outcome of this, as long as the people in power are still in power. But think about how fast that White House cocaine story got squelched.
Yep.
That should have been a major story. There should have been an investigation. You're talking about a facility that probably has no such thing as a blank spot with cameras. I mean, that's probably a fair assessment, right?
I have to imagine.
I mean, there's cameras every place. How can someone bring in a bag of white powder and no one see them?
Right. I think they did. I think they know what happened there, and I think they covered it up. I think that they're going to do the same thing here. And what leads me to that, I would love to have a Secret Service agency that was above the fray, was nonpartisan, and could just come out and tell the truth, lay the facts out for us. But they're already proven that they can't do that. In fact, they've already lied to us multiple times in this whole ordeal. And directly, first of all, they came out with that little sloped argument. So Cheadle was on the interview saying,
very steep roof. Yeah.
Very steep roof that was about the same slope as your shower. It's ridiculous.
Yeah, about a 5-degree pitch, if that.
Yeah. And there were the counter snipers on the opposite roof were on a slope that was much greater than that. So just visually. Yeah. And visually. So right then and there, that was obviously you could call it a fib or a lie. I don't think it was true. It was an excuse as to why
the pitch
there wasn't
of that roof, folks, was less than a handicap ramp.
Right. And the gentlemen who went up to investigate it were walking across it, no problem. After the shooter had been taken out, there were a bunch of people up there looking down on the body of the shooter. So it's clearly traversable. The shooter was able to maneuver on there.
Right. So people in a wheelchair or on crutches can maneuver this, but Secret Service agents couldn't go up there because it was too dangerous.
Right. So that to me means that she says, we considered it, we made an analysis, it was too dangerous. So we have some documented, chronicled evidence that we didn't secure that building. But in addition to that, she then blamed the local police. She said that the local cops were inside the building and they had secured the perimeter. And that was an out and out lie. In fact, the local police, there was a guy called Naftali who posted on Facebook an update. He was the township, I think, clerk or something, or some position in the township. And he said that they informed the Secret Service that they could not secure the building. They actually even wanted, the Secret Service requested that they post up a patrol car there. And they informed Secret Service, we can't do that. We don't have the manpower. And they were specifically there for traffic and overflow. So for the Secret Service then to blame them, I think is also part of the cover-up. They're trying to point the fingers at other people because they engineered a failure. They had multiple decision points. They saw the shooter multiple times, took his picture, got on the roof, saw him again, brought Trump out, saw him again, let the shot go off. Then they did something. So every one of those, in my opinion, is a volitional act that when you aggregate them, it leads to some intentionality on behalf of some people in the Secret Service. And I'm not saying that they, you know, intended for him to shoot Trump in the head, but they intended to not allow this place to be secure. And that leads to criminal culpability in many other instances. And so the question should that apply to the Secret Service too?
So years ago, when I was in law enforcement, I was a cop. I was part of a detail to secure President Reagan. And I can tell you, so the local police, our job was traffic. Our job was abandoned cars. If your car broke down on the side of the road 5 minutes before the motorcade was coming, your car was being towed away. And our job, because in our city, the president would pass through our city going from the airport to downtown Detroit. So our job was to make sure there were no cars on the freeway, no people on the freeway, and to put a cop on every overpass. That's what we did. It would not have been securing spots at the president's speaking site.
Right.
It would have been, it is a motorcade transportation traffic event for local police. This was not a local cop job. What do you think is going to come of this?
Well, I think we're going to see a very slow process here. I know that the Department of Homeland Security just appointed some bipartisan commission to start looking at this. And Mayorkas just released that. It's going to be Janet Napolitano, who used to be the governor of Arizona, which is where mm-hmm. I'm from, before she became DHS person, ultra left, mega Democrat. And then the other people who are going to be on it are Bush people. So ex-Bush people from that homeland team. So between the two of them, I'm not so sure that we're going to get any truth or any clarity on what happened. I don't know that, you know, either of them are fans of Trump or are going to really hold the Secret Service accountable, or at least the leadership accountable, to some of these failures or get to the bottom of it. Who made the decision to bring Trump out while there was a prospective shooter on the stage, for example? Are we going to see that? Know who that is? Is anybody going to be fired for that? I doubt it. And I also
nobody
heard
gets
that
fired under this administration
ever. Right. And I also heard from Cheadle just this morning. She's testifying that she's expecting about 60 days out for her full report, which I'm sure will be a preliminary report. So the question is, are we going to get anything before the election? If we do, it sounds like it's going to drop right in September. And as per usual, I think that there's very little ramifications for anybody who's in these institutions. The institutions protect themselves. The Secret Service will have the protection of Merrick Garland from the DOJ. Christopher Wray and the FBI will be covering up for the Secret Service. They're all in cahoots with each other. So I think the real solution will become and be coming from the next administration.
Yeah, this will be referred to as a comedy of errors. Now, unfortunate mistakes and circumstances and coincidences.
Yep.
Because you are to believe that dozens of negative coincidences is not a pattern.
Right.
You know, one thing is not a pattern. Two things might not be a pattern. Three things starts to look like a pattern. 20 yep. things is a freaking pattern.
Right. Yeah, it's especially when it's your entire job, right? Your entire yeah. job is to make job. Sure this doesn't happen.
My belief on this right now is, no, I do not think that the government hired this 20-year-old kid to go shoot President Trump. But it also is, this kid, as I said, wasn't Jason Bourne.
Right.
That was this, you know, brilliantly, highly trained assassin. He was just some loser kid that took his father's AR-15 out of the house.
Right.
Now, what I find interesting is right now the Democrats are more focused on the fact that he bought 50 rounds of ammunition that morning than they are the fact that the Secret Service failed to protect the former president of the United States. So the first thing is, going to a gun store and buying 50 rounds of ammunition would not be a red flag, because there's 25 rounds in a box.
Right.
So you went to the store and you bought two boxes of ammunition. That's not even a range day. If you're going to the range, you'd use more than 50 rounds of ammunition. So they're focused on, why didn't we have a red flag on somebody buying 50 rounds of ammo, versus where was the red flag on people yelling at law enforcement, there's a man on the roof with a gun.
Exactly. And you never let a crisis go to waste. They Correct. Take that gun AR-15 narrative and they just run that into the ground. We saw Jamie Raskin was talking about that today and saying that Trump was attacked in a mass shooting. It's like, well, this is not exactly a mass shooting. This was an assassination attempt. They are definitely Right. different. And to write it off as political violence was the other story from them, right? Oh, this is just more standardized political violence. No, this wasn't, right? The Secret Service were there to stop this from happening. And I understand and agree, I think, with the position that we haven't seen any evidence that the government orchestrated or maneuvered this shooter into position. But there are a lot of crazy people in the world, right? When you think about it, just with the law of big numbers, if you have 330 million Americans, and let's say 1% of those are maybe not well, and then you take 1% of that 1% who might are actually, you know, crazy, might actually shoot somebody, we're still talking about like 33,000 people there who are in that category. And so the Secret Service, I think, knows that. We know that this other guy was communicating with some other people. He had a bunch of encrypted accounts. So I'm sure there was somebody on the other end of those calls and those messages. But
we'll never know,
but they don't have to, you know, necessarily maneuver him into position. They just open up a window, and they know that because of this law of big numbers, because there just happens to be a big percentage, tens of thousands of people who might be crazy enough, who might actually know how to shoot a gun, and who also believe that Trump is a Nazi, Trump is Hitler, ending American democracy, going to put women, you know, in birthing centers or whatever they believe from MSNBC. They just have to open a window and allow the context and the environment to create itself. And that's where
I believe that the Secret Service was ordered to give the appearance of protection.
I think we see a pattern of that.
Yeah, it's the appearance of protection, not actual protection. So let me start at the federal level. Do we have any federal agencies? And I'm not counting the Supreme Court, because the Supreme Court is a equal branch of government, which I think is interesting that the Congress now wants to try to control an equal branch of government, which seems that would be, and you're the lawyer, that seems very unconstitutional to me.
It is.
But we'll talk about that in a minute. Are there any three-lettered agencies in America right now, through all of your work on watching the Watchers, that we could consider to be valid or trustworthy?
I would say as a federal agency, no. the people at the top of the federal agencies, I'm just running through them. Alejandro Mayorkas of Homeland, absolutely not. You've got
DOJ, FBI,
Ray,
DEA, ATF.
I would say that
Department
the people,
of Education, IRS.
I can't think of one. And that's because they're political appointees. And the Secret Service, as we know, was somebody who was very close with Jill, Dr. Jill, so-called. And mm-hmm. so I think that they're in line with the administration. Now, there are some other, you know, the OIGs, we call them. So the Department of Homeland Security has their Office of the Inspector General. And these are supposed to be different independent agencies that investigate and review themselves, as you mentioned earlier. You know, they investigate themselves. They find they did nothing wrong. There's one guy, and his name escapes me right now, but I know that DHS OIG was opening up an investigation into some of this. And I know Thomas Massie, who's a representative, who I think is a pretty strong representative, mm-hmm. endorsed the gentleman who was leading that. So he posted an X and said that he was doing great work on it and he's a trustworthy guy. So that's where we look to, I think, until there's a changing of the guard and the changing of those political position happens under a Trump administration. I think we're going to continue to see this cover up, and they all cover for each other, right? DOJ covers for the FBI, FBI covers for the DOJ. They're all going to cover for the Secret Service, and around we go.
So we see prosecutors, local, state, federal prosecutors all coming after Trump. And I think a lot of people think about, well, you know, he's President Trump. He's, you know, he causes a lot of chaos and it makes sense that these people go after him, but they're not going to bother me. I'm not Trump. So I don't really need to worry about what Fannie Willis does or Alvin Bragg does or even Smith, who doesn't even have the authority to be a federal prosecutor, does. But is that really the case, or do we all have something to fear?
I think technically we all do have something to fear. There's that great quote, show me the man, I'll show you the crime. Or mm-hmm. another one, you know, to my friends, everything, to my enemies, the law, right? So the law can be a very pernicious thing that people can take advantage of. We had a very nice pattern in this country for 234 years. We had functional immunity where we didn't have political prosecutions against political opponents. Joe Biden and the Democrats wrecked all of that. We've had four of them thus far. And I think that the pendulum, honestly, I hope the pendulum does swing the other way. And I say this as a lawyer, somebody who loves the law, the logic of the law, and I appreciate it, I think, immensely. And it saddens me that we're in this new phase. But if the Republicans don't strike back, if they don't find the courage and the fortitude to play this game like the Democrats are playing, I think that they're going to ultimately lose. I think they're probably going to get evaporated.
I mean, should we play this game or should we just try to gut all these agencies, get Trump elected and gut these agencies and get back to decency and normalcy? But you really think we need to strike back?
Well, I think the people who, I think they broke the law in what they've done to Trump. I think that these RICO cases were political prosecutions. I think what Jack Smith did, he stole $24 million illegally from indefinite appropriations from the DOJ. And I want to see some accountability for it. So the Republicans, I think, don't want to strike back a lot of the time. They just say, we're going to be above the fray. We're not going to be like the Democrats. And then the Democrats just continue to escalate. And I think a lot of people, before Trump got indicted four times, were saying to themselves, the Democrats would never do this. They would never cross that Rubicon. They did it four times. And then they tried to throw Trump off the ballot. Now, arguably, they enabled him to be dead. So if the Republicans just, you know, come back in and say, we're just going to take the high road again, I don't know that that's going to ultimately solve anything. I think that might just be kicking the can down the road until the Democrats have power again. I would like to see some repercussion for the people who shattered the Constitution, who wrecked the justice system, who broke 234 years of functional precedent, because I think what they did was criminal. I mean, they're trying to rig an election openly right in front of our eyes right now, and they're using the law as cover to do it.
So what's your opinion of this judge, what's his name, Marchin in New York?
Yeah, judge, we call him Mercon. I don't know why we call him that, but we call him Judge Mercon. I think it's kind of has a nice rhyme. His first name's Juan, so we say Juan Mercon. But Judge Mercon is a Democrat Hack, he's a Democrat operative. I think he has somebody, he donated $35 to Joe Biden twice. Those are two political donations, like spite donations, where he's just, $15 and $20, firing those off. His daughter is somebody who worked for Joe and Kamala, raised $93 million mm-hmm. for the Democrats.
Yeah, she's deep into it.
And he allowed one of the most insane, ridiculous trials to happen. And I think he is in hot water. His case is on the rocks. He just postponed the sentencing. Trump was already supposed to be sentenced and maybe even in jail right now. But the immunity decision from the Supreme Court came back down. And Judge Mercon really screwed that case badly because Trump raised an immunity objection before the trial started, in the middle of the trial, multiple times, and the judge overruled him. So now that the Supreme Court came back down and said that the president does have immunity, Mercon is stuck because in the trial, he allowed a bunch of what I would argue is protected conduct and evidence to come into trial. So, for example, this was the business records case, this New York case saying that Trump paid Michael Cohen some evidence to pay off Stormy Daniels, or paid Cohen some money to pay off Stormy Daniels. The problem with all this is the checks were written to Michael Cohen in 2017 when Trump was the president. So arguably presidential immunity applies to that act. And the judge didn't investigate that at all. But in addition to that,
worst case scenario, then it's a retrial.
Yeah, so they would have to, exactly. So it's a mistrial, a motion for a new trial. But as it stands right now, evidence came into that trial that should not have, including Oval Office evidence. I mean, they brought in Madeline Westerhout and Hope Hicks, two witnesses who worked for Trump in the White House. Like Hope Hicks was the chief communications director and Westerhout was the Oval Office director. So they asked her questions about sitting outside the Oval Office. That's all official conduct. That's all at least arguably immunized, should have never come into trial. Trump objected before the trial started. Mercon overruled him, and did so contrary to the Supreme Court. So that case, I mean,
there's got to be 30, 40 appealable events that happened in that trial.
Yeah, I would say at least. And the problem is that Trump was appealing those things, but it just goes up to the New York Court of Appeals, which is just as bad as the lower level court. So
Where does it go from there? Supreme Court?
Well, now, yeah, the Supreme Court has weighed in on the immunity decision. So practically the way that we believe this is going to work, and it hasn't functioned this way yet, we haven't seen it happen yet, but the immunity decision protects Trump really in all of his cases. I mean, it was a really strong decision because the Democrats, Jack Smith, Merrick Garland, and the local state prosecutors were trying to criminalize his official conduct. Trump, in my opinion, didn't break the law at all in any of these cases. They were purely political. But what happened is the Supreme Court made the immunity decision for the January 6th case, which is the case out of the DC Circuit Court. And so she did the right thing, Judge Chutkan, in that courtroom. Trump made the immunity objection, said, Your Honor, we think we have presidential immunity. She knew what was going to happen if she overruled it. So she stopped it and allowed that case to go up to the Supreme Court. So it will come back down. We'll have an evidentiary hearing in her courtroom where they're going to ask about Trump's official conduct. And right on January 6th, is the president allowed to give a speech about a rigged election? Is that personal or official? So we're going to go through that analysis for all of the charged conduct in the indictment. And then Chutkan will make a decision. And in my opinion, she's going to say that Trump can be prosecuted for at least some things. She's going to find there's not immunity. So then at that moment, Trump will appeal that to the DC Circuit. They'll probably agree with Chutkan. Then he'll appeal that to SCOTUS again. So we'll be back on immunity again to determine if this type of conduct is official or non-official. But that's in Judge Chutkan's courtroom. So in Mercon's, he did not do that. He did not allow that whole process to unwind. He just overruled Trump, said, oh, absolutely no immunity at all. SCOTUS just said, he does have immunity. So that, and Trump has not been sentenced yet.
So that would have been part of the trial. The trial should have been operated, assuming that immunity happened now, because we know that, which would mean that entire trial was a sham trial. I mean, we knew it was a sham trial, but that whole trial is bad.
Exactly. Yeah. And Trump's defense just submitted a motion to dismiss and dismiss the verdict, right?
The odds that Martian will actually
Probably low. I think he is a Democrat hack operative, and he would love to put Trump in prison if he could. He's going to be pretty tightly limited by the Supreme Court. So I think he's going to try to find a way to cobble it together. Trump will appeal it. I ultimately think this case is going to die. It's just a matter of how and when. I don't think anything is going
to be the judge on this case, since he's not even a judge in rotation.
It's been an interesting history there. Yeah, he's like an acting judge. He's had multiple different Trump cases assigned to him. So he
always
had,
gets the Trump cases.
Always. The CFO, Alan Weisselberg case. He just had Bannon's case, although that was reassigned just very recently. He had multiple cases, and it's very curious, right? New York is not a favorable jurisdiction to Trump, and we're always wondering how he gets these judges and these juries, and it's like a cesspool.
So how big of a chilling effect is this putting on other businesses that are operating in New York?
Well, I got to imagine it's major. I don't have any firsthand experience of that, but I've seen a lot of concern from people like Kevin O'Leary was speaking out a lot about this, and other big Grant Cardone, some of the other big like real estate
I've
moguls.
Seen quite
there.
A few good sized companies bail out of New York and head to Florida.
Wow. Okay. I believe it. If you can have an AG like Letitia James just come in, whether it's, she took, you know, basically $500 million, or is threatening to take $500 million of property from Trump because of, she disagreed with some evaluations, some financial Crazy. Evaluations of the company. And it's, people
and
are asking themselves.
It was that Mar-a-Lago is worth $18 million.
Right.
And the parking lot at Mar-a-Lago is worth $18 million.
Right. And that judge was another judge. That whole trial was also insane. That was Judge Engoron, whose law clerk was very close friends with Chuck Schumer, was sitting up there co-judging with him. And they had just an absolute animosity towards Trump. And it was a weird situation in there, because Trump's defense attorney, Alina Abba, was noticing that the judge and the clerk were constantly talking with each other. Why is this clerk basically guiding the judge? And so we came back into trial the next day, and they moved all the cameras around so you couldn't see the judge. And then they gagged Alina Abba from commenting on that. They gagged Trump from commenting on it. And it's just one big railroad effort after another in New York.
Yeah, Trump's First Amendment rights were absolutely trashed during these trials. Now, what about the Fannie Willis case? Where's that going?
Yeah, multiple gag orders. In the January 6th case, we had the Mercon case, the Alvin Bragg case, where Trump was also gagged about talking about the judge's daughter. In the Letitia James case, he couldn't talk about the clerk. And then in Florida, before that case got dismissed, they were trying for another gag there. But Fannie is really the only one. Fannie Willis is the Georgia case. That's the RICO case, which was 19 co-defendants. We had four other people take plea deals on that one, which were basically diversion deals. So Sidney Powell, Jenna Ellis
took one.
Yeah, they took those deals. And then there were, the case was still pending. The big issue on this was, of course, the Fannie Willis, Nathan Wade love affair. So Fannie Willis hired her lover, Nathan Wade, this other special prosecutor, this guy she knew for a long time, paid him $700,000.
And paid him a higher wage than higher hourly pay than the other consultants who actually had experience in RICO, and he had none.
Yeah, exactly right. And she then went out and was lecturing everybody after this came to light. They had multiple trips together, and there's all these disclosure requirements, right?
She paid him back in cash, Robert.
Paid him back in cash.
Mountains of cash in her house.
Yeah, thousands of dollars. She always got it from, you know, when you go swipe your debit card, would you like cash back with that? $40 cash back. Yes, here
it
you go,
adds
honey.
It adds up, man. It piles up it after does, a while. Yeah.
Totally believable, totally plausible. And she kept it at home, you know, just kind of in a mattress or something. We don't really know. But all of that happens. We ask ourselves whether there was a major conflict there, because if Nathan Wade, the special prosecutor, were to make a decision like there's no probable cause here to bring a criminal charge, it's over, right? The gravy train's over. He doesn't get the money. He can't afford to take her to Belize, to Napa Valley for wine trips. They went on multiple cruises all over the place. Mm-hmm. We were wondering, it was like, I think five trips in 6 months, something like that. It was amazing. Yep. And Nathan Wade was getting all of that money from Fulton County. He was getting paid. He billed like 24 hours in a day one time. There are meetings between Nathan Wade and at least Fannie Willis and the White House, right? White House counsel, Kamala's office, all the stuff. So it turned into a major conflict of interest. Then Fannie was lying on the stand about a bunch of different things they put in written documents. And long story short, it was one of the most insane times where a prosecutor was on the stand talking about her love affairs. It was surreal. But long story short, Judge McAfee split the baby on that, said, okay, Fannie Willis can stay on this case. Your lover has to go. So Nathan Wade is gone. He's fine. He left. He took his 700 grand. He divorced his wife, left his kids overseas, whatever. And he's just having a nice time. But Fannie now is continuing to prosecute the case. And Trump and the defense have appealed that. They basically said, Judge, this is ridiculous. It's like if two people go in and rob a bank, you just say that the situation is solved if we let one of the bank robbers go. Like both of these people were involved in criminality or in, at least involved in conflict of interest as prosecutors. They're held to a higher standard. And so they're saying that Fannie also needs to go. They've appealed that. Georgia Court of Appeals are very slow. So you need permission from the lower court to appeal. Then you need permission for the higher court to accept the appeal. Then once they accept it, then they set oral arguments out. So that case is basically dead in the water until next. I think there's a hearing in December, so well after the election. But by the time we get the oral arguments and all the rulings on it, right, Trump may be well in the White House. And honestly, Fannie Willis may not even be around anymore. And I think that because of the fact that the Court of Appeals accepted the appeal, they're not happy with Judge McAfee's lower ruling. I think they're probably going to agree that Fannie needs to go.
Can Trump write himself a pardon that would just kill all this stuff and just wipe it all out? Or does he not have that ability in state courts?
He wouldn't have that ability in state courts, arguably. But the presidential immunity decision is probably going to give him protection in the RICO case as well. So anything, any evidence that is official acts evidence of the presidency is arguably immune. And actually presumptively immune is what the Supreme Court said. So Fannie's, I forget how many different overt acts are in her RICO indictment, but it's massive. So Trump, there's a lot of power of the presidency, a lot of pressure he can put on certain things. And I'm sure he could handle that in other ways. But I think that even if Fannie stays on the case, if Fannie gets off the case, if they boot her off the case, I don't think another prosecutor will take it. Right, so it'll probably be dead on arrival there. And if somebody else takes it, Trump's got immunity. So they'd have to distinguish the non-official from the official acts. And it's so commingled in the indictment, I'm not sure that they could do that.
Now, Judge Cannon dismissed the presidential records case. I've looked at the case. You're a lawyer. I'm not. I've looked at the case with my experience and said, okay, this seemed like a good ruling, especially when you consider that Jack Smith has zero authority to bring the case. Now, the Democrats are all saying she's a political hack and she broke the law and she needs to be impeached and thrown off the bench. What do you think will happen in that case? Will they go after the judge? Are they going to try to re-prosecute it? What goes on there?
Yeah, they always say that about people that are not in their pocket, right? Every other judge has been gagging Trump, threatening him, and allowing insane evidence to come in from witnesses like Michael Cohen, who's a convicted perjurer. No problem. He can come in and testify in multiple different cases, right? So, and they love those judges. They love the judges.
A convicted liar and a lying porn star.
Exactly, right. They love those witnesses. Democrats, big fans of those judges. But when Judge Cannon does actually the right thing here and reviews Jack Smith's authority, they lose their bananas over it. But it was an excellent ruling, and I thought that it was well needed. Long story short, what happened here is Jack Smith is not lawfully appointed. So the way that it works under our Constitution is we have something called the Appointments Clause, which means that if you're going to appoint somebody to an office, they need to be appointed by the president and confirmed by the Senate, right? We see this all the time.
Just like being in the cabinet.
Exactly. Yeah. And for U.S. attorneys, right? So U.S. attorneys, you don't even have to be at that high level, but U.S. attorneys who run these different offices are at least appointed. So for example, the U.S. attorney who's prosecuting Hunter Biden is named David Weiss. I think he's a political hack, a a friend of the Bidens, but he's still appointed.
But he's an employee. He does work for the federal government.
Exactly right. And so he has a basis.
Smith did not work for the federal government, correct?
He did not. In fact, he was a private citizen who was appointed. So Merrick Garland wrote out this appointment order.
Who has no authority to do such.
He does not, because there is no office created for the special counsel. It's very complex history, but we used to have an independent counsel, which is what Congress created by law, and then they could fill it, and then they could put appropriate money for that office. But after a while, they let the independent counsel statutes expire because it was really kind of a mess. It was being politicized and it was being a mess. So Congress let it expire. So what happened then is Janet Reno, after they lost this independent counsel power, she created what are called the Reno regulations. Mm-hmm. And so she just wrote essentially rules. So we have the Constitution, which tells us how to make statutes, which is what Congress does. And then once we have statutes, we have regulations. So what Reno did, because these agencies write these regulations, she just wrote regulations and cobbled together all of these various statutes from the U.S. code. And she said, we have power to appoint special counsels. And for years, nobody really challenged that. Everybody just said, well, I guess they can kind of do it, whatever. But they appointed Jack Smith. Trump challenged it, said, you were a private citizen from the International Criminal Court. You were never appointed as a U.S. attorney. None of these statutes give you the power that you claim. You're acting like a full-blown prosecutor. You're acting like even more powerful than a U.S. attorney, because you can prosecute Trump in multiple jurisdictions. You have virtually no oversight from Merrick Garland. So you're like an officer of your own agency. Yeah, so they basically
branch of government at that point.
It is basically. They gave this guy all the power in the world, and he has no lawful basis for being there. And so Judge Cannon just went through Merrick Garland's order. Merrick Garland said, okay, U.S. code, this section, you know, 512, 5114, 516, went through all of them and said that applies to the FBI. That applies to you hiring a janitor. This applies to you. None of it applies to you. And in addition to that, if you have no valid office, then you have no money to go to that office. And what the DOJ was doing, it's sick, but they were still dipping into, they have an indefinite fund, essentially, that was created for the independent counsel that has, it's a slush fund. There's no limit to the mm-hmm. amount of money. And so they just appointed all of that to Jack Smith and said, go wild. So Cannon came out and said, you have no valid office. You have no valid statutes. You have no valid money. $24 million is now gone from the U.S. taxpayers. And so you're done, and dismissed the whole case.
Now the Supreme Court made another ruling outside of this case recently where they actually killed regulation too, right?
I'm not sure which one that is. They also had a January 6 case on 1512, which is the corruptly
right.
portion of that charge.
Supreme Court's ruling that government agencies didn't have the right to create regulations.
Yes, you're talking about the Chevron decision. Chevron. Yeah, the Chevron decision.
So which they was killed the Chevron defense. Wouldn't that also affect this?
Yeah, I think there will be some. Yeah, maybe some overlap between that. I hadn't thought about that connection, but yeah, it's basically the agencies don't have the authority to write laws for themselves and govern themselves.
Which would then add more energy to the argument that Merrick Garland didn't have the right to create laws, neither did Janet Reno.
Right. Yeah, and they're very upset about this. I think this was a great ruling because it's indicative of just how our government works. We give them a little bit of power, they take everything. And they tried to do that here, much to the detriment of the entire country. They prosecuted Trump. They raided, Jack Smith raided his house, took photos of Melania's bedroom, took photos of Barron's bedroom. There are no classified documents in there. So it was a total scam. And Cannon threw it out. Jack Smith has filed his notice of appeal with the 11th Circuit. But the issue here is that Clarence Thomas, in the immunity decision, which would also apply to the classified documents case, mm-hmm. he wrote a concurring opinion where he explained that Jack Smith was not lawful, and it wasn't in the majority holding. So in other words, it's not the new law of the land.
Source of law, so to speak.
Yeah, but it's very persuasive. And Clarence Thomas is the person who governs and presides over that 11th Circuit. So the 11th Circuit, we'll see what they do with this. I was actually quite shocked that Cannon went this far. I think it was the right call and a really heroic move of her
was
to take on that type of pressure. But it was the right move logically. The opinion was brilliant. She went into a bunch of areas that she didn't even need to go into to pre-butt Jack Smith's response. And so we're going to keep waiting on that one.
How he's doing an appeal when he shouldn't even have access to money.
I know, it's really amazing.
Where is he getting the money to file the appeal?
It's amazing. The DOJ is standing behind him. The DOJ just says it's, you know, they say it's our money, so we're going to spend it accordingly. And it's basically
it's
a standing
our money.
I know it is. I know it's, and it's $24 million, and a lot of it's been used to just go after Trump. And when they spend that money, right, they're built to prosecute. So they already have offices, they already have prosecutors, team, mm-hmm. and all that. Trump has to stand up a defense. So for him to respond to $24 million in capitals, I don't know, maybe three times that, four times that.
Now, what about the issue when we look at this? How come there was no raid on Biden's house? And where are they coming up with this presidential privilege or presidential immunity argument to not release the interview tapes from her, which was a correct special prosecutor?
And right.
they've released a transcript, but they're claiming presidential immunity and presidential privilege allows them to not release the interview.
Right, which I think is just another political decision from a corrupt DOJ, ultimately.
I wonder if Pelosi didn't threaten to find a way to release that if Biden didn't step down.
That's another interesting idea. Maybe that was the leverage. Somebody would leak something there. Their argument is that, and it's a terrible argument, is that it's, if they release it, it might implicate other investigations. And so the response is, are you investigating other presidents with classified documents or other senators? You know, if they,
but you already released the transcript.
Exactly. So the privilege is also broken.
Unless you're going to say the transcript wasn't complete, which you claim it is.
Right. And we know it isn't because. Right.
So are you lying then or are you lying now?
Yeah. Always pretty much is the answer.
It is shocking how bad this is. Well, we have a couple minutes left and then I want to get you to tell us about your program. What's your opinion now of Harris as president? And I want to start that by saying my contacts around her tell me that she is lazy, doesn't read briefings, doesn't attend briefings, is always ill-prepared, which you can see. And I think that's why the laughing, and I think that's why the word salad, because I don't know what to say right now. I didn't read the briefings. I don't know what to say. I mean, you remember, I don't know if you remember, she at one speech claimed that Ukraine was part of NATO, which I'm watching her say that, and I'm like, holy crap, you just announced World War III.
Right.
So how do you, I mean, do you think she's going to all of a sudden become a workhorse and she's going to change her stripes and all of a sudden she's going to become informed, or is she still going to look like an idiot on the stump?
I don't think she can help it. I think Kamala is going to continue to come off as Kamala. Now the facade, the amount of paint they're going to try to dump all over this campaign is going to be wild. I think probably unlike anything we've ever seen before, but I can see them trying to recreate Obama 2.0 or something like this, right? Give her all this flowery stuff, this flowery speech, and re-engineer a campaign for her. But she's pretty terrible. We saw how she did in the Democratic primaries versus Tulsi Gabbard.
But we know she'll be unburdened by what has been. We do know that. So, and I'm assuming that now means Biden to be unburdened by a has-been.
Right. And now we all get to be burdened by what will be with Kamala. It's going to be great.
So, I mean, do you think she's got any ghost of a chance here? Will they pull it off? Will they figure out a way to steal it? What's our risk here?
My concern is about the steal. I think that the Democrats are very well funded and organizationally crafty. So we've covered on our channel a bunch of the cheating of the Democrats. Back in 2020, we covered all the litigation where they used COVID as the pretext to change the election rules, violating the Constitution, usurping the state legislatures to change the election dates or to enable ballot drop boxes. Or there were some places where they were waiving signature requirements. Just check the box, you're good.
Bird flu is floating around out there, just waiting to become a pandemic.
They are. They're waiting for that one. I know. I've been seeing that one a lot. But in addition to that, even this year, we had Shenna Bellows from Colorado. We had Griswold. from other places. I think Bellows was in Maine. Griswold was in Colorado. We had Jocelyn Benson in Michigan. They're trying to cheat right now. They tried to throw Trump off the ballot twice in two different states. SCOTUS had to correct them on that. And in Michigan, Jocelyn Benson in 2020, she had the signatures had a presumption of validity when they came through. So in other words, they didn't check them because they were presumed valid. So there was a bunch of lawsuits that took place in Michigan ever since 2020 that was disallowed. So then this year, again, Jocelyn Benson tried to change because she can't do presumption of validity anymore. So she then tried to change it in the rules and the election manuals and all the stuff into initial presumption of validity. Got sued again. Judge just threw that out. So my point is, these people haven't learned. They haven't changed. They are still going to try to cheat. They're still going to try to wave signatures and collect a bunch of ballots. And they're the referees in the game on in their states, right?
So it doesn't matter who's, it doesn't matter who's doing the voting. It matters who's counting.
Exactly. And if they don't have Joe at the top of the ticket, they're going to throw him into a trash bag and over a bridge and say, none of those policies are ours. We don't stink like him. This is new. Kamala, they'll say, has plausibility for victory, right? So she will awaken the African-American vote, or they'll bring in some new VP candidate. And this new candidate will have some new energy and new excitement and enthusiasm, blah, blah, blah. And that will give them a pretext and plausibility to steal everything. And they'll just point to this new fresh face again, which is why I think they're excited about this. They don't want, if they kept Joe and Joe wins, no one is going to believe that at all.
Right.
But someone else, fresh new face, maybe some people believe it.
So who do you think, any guess on who the VP is going to be?
I haven't thought that far ahead yet. I know that a lot of people are talking about a white guy, right? Just a standard white guy to kind of balance that ticket out so that it has some
Buttigieg.
Buttigieg, yeah.
Because he's a white guy with a special interest spin.
He does have that.
So he
I don't know if he qualifies
as DEI, even though he's a white guy.
Yeah. And where is he from? Ohio?
Indiana.
Indiana. Okay. Yeah. So I'm thinking also geographically, right? If Kamala's from California, maybe you pick someone on that other, on the other coast. They also have an interesting split. I know that there was a, some people talking about Josh Shapiro. I think Pennsylvania might be a good pickup, but they've got a lot, they've got a lot of fractures and fissures in their party. They also have the Israel-Gaza situation, which I think has created a big fracture. So they're going to have to figure out how to cobble this back together.
I'm thinking they're looking at Buttigieg or possibly Gretchen Whitmer. But I don't know if Big Gretch would take it or not, because she really wants to be president. And I'm wondering if she'd be too worried about being tainted by this failure.
Right.
I also wonder if part of Biden's motivation wasn't the fact that he now realizes he has no pathway and he doesn't want to have the loss on his record. That maybe I'd rather walk away and say I never lost.
Maybe.
Than to say that I lost to Donald Trump.
Yeah, there's been a lot of that. There's been a lot of the pressure saying this is your legacy. And I've heard people saying if you don't leave and you lose, you'll destroy your legacy. You'll let, you know, you'll let Trump recreate everything.
As currently, as of last weekend, Biden had no pathway to the White House.
Right.
Through the swing states. And there are states in play right now under with Biden in the ticket. There were states in play that shouldn't even have been in play.
Right.
Places like Virginia. I mean, Wisconsin's in play. I mean, there's all kinds of places in play that shouldn't have been. Before we end, tell us about the show and how people can find it and what you're doing on your show.
Yeah, thanks for that. I appreciate being here. Thanks for having me on. We are a show called Watching the Watchers Live. We live stream 5 days a week on YouTube, Rumble, and X. And the show is about holding police, prosecutors, and politicians. We focus on the federal level, so not local stuff, accountable. We shine a spotlight at justice. And our mission is to bring accountability and transparency down upon our system. So we just examine cases. Right now, we've been covering all of the Trump cases, defending him in all four of those criminal indictments. We're also talking about all of the assassination stuff now. So we pulled documents up on the screen. So when the Judiciary Committee or the Homeland Security Committee or oversight committees, right, when they send letters out and do their investigations, we zoom in on the documents so we can really see what's happening. We have a lot of fun. We have a great community.
And that's a big job doing that daily.
We have a lot of fun. There's a lot to cover. And honestly, we can't get to it all.
I know. It's a huge commitment. We do this program once a week, and it's like, okay, we can't even be current once a week nowadays at the speed things that are moving.
I know. Yeah, it goes fast. That's why I live stream a lot of it, is because even when I'm preparing for the live stream, even sometimes when I'm on the live stream, something changes, something pops, and we just try to
absolutely
squeeze it all in.
Absolutely. Well, folks, Robert, thanks for being with us. Folks, I want you to make sure that you go give Watching the Watchers a shot. We'll have, so Matt will have links in the show notes to it. So you don't need to worry about writing it down right now. Go to the show notes. There'll be links to it so that you can just go click in and watch the program. I'm going to watch the program. And Robert, I hope you'll come back sometime and be with us again. It was great having you here. You're super knowledgeable. And it's nice getting the legal spin on some of this stuff.
My pleasure, Dr. Mark. Thank you so much for having me. Had a great time. Okay.
If you enjoyed today's show, please make sure you go to wherever you get your podcast. Leave us a 5-star review. If you're not subscribed, subscribe to us. And here's the thing. This podcast, like every podcast, the majority of people are not subscribed. The majority of people are not leaving reviews. But when you leave those reviews, it helps move us up. It helps boost us up so that we can try to reach more people. We reach more people and you get better guests. And it just has a snowball event, you know, snowball effect. So take a minute and go do that if you would, please. We'd appreciate that. And other than that, we will see you next week when God knows what will happen in the news in 1 week's period of time. We are, I don't know how else to say that. We are living in what will become recorded history on a daily basis right now. We'll see you on the next episode of Blunt Force Truth.